Howdy, this is Mackenzie Franklin from SideGame LLC here in Colorado Springs, Colorado. Today we're going to talk about five more rules mistakes in board games. Now, as owner of the SideGame library here, I'm constantly learning new games so that I can teach them, and sometimes I'm going to miss a couple of things. In addition, sometimes I've played a game so much that I think I know the rules that maybe somebody else had taught me, and then I learn the correct rules from somebody later who's like, wait, that's not how that works. So in this one, we're going to see a little bit of both of those things, but without further ado, let's go ahead and jump in and see, oh man, what is it this time? Five more board game rules mistakes. Now, the first game I want to talk about is Parks. So Parks is a game where you play as a couple of hikers going down this path, and you're going to be collecting resources in order to visit as many parks as you can. Now, my favorite part about Parks is the artwork. I think it's so beautiful. It's from the 59 Parks print series, and it's a wonderful, wonderful, beautiful experience as you kind of walk through and collect these different large tarot-sized cards. So love the artwork in this game. However, it's been a while. We had a friend teach us this a while back, and we recently got a copy for the library a little bit ago when the Nightfall expansion came out. But the rule that we got wrong on this one was that how the path mechanism at the end works every round. So this game uses a path mechanism. So you see this in games like Tokaido, in games like Glenmore Chronicles, and in games like Heaven and Hell, where you simply can move as far as you'd like on this path, but by doing so, you're limiting your options for future turns. And I think that's a great mechanic. Now, in here, each character has two pieces, and you can move either of those pieces, and eventually you'll get to the end, so as you can see here. Now, the thing that we were doing wrong is, in this game, when one player was left on the track, we just ended the round, and that's it, nothing else. So it was really bad if you were the last person on the track, because you would get one less action than everybody else. It was very punishing to kind of not prioritize getting to the end, because losing an entire action is huge. Now, that was wrong. We were not supposed to play like that. The actual rule is, whoever triggers the end of the game, the last person on the path, their character or characters, if there are multiple there, they are forced to the end of the trail, and they are allowed to perform a single action. So they will get at least one more action if they're forced to the end, but they won't lose that additional momentum. So huge thing, because that could be useful for, you know, getting that extra action to collect that additional park, which could be the difference between, you know, a couple points. So that's a pretty big deal for this game, because that's kind of what you're building towards, right, is completing those parks. And you only have four seasons to do it. So big difference here. So that has been remedied and changed, and a lot of cheers at the table when we realized this was the case, and a lot of angry people because they had lost their actions in the previous games that they had played. So that is Parks, and that is making sure that when somebody triggers the end of the round, the last person on the trail gets forced to the end and they get to take an action. The next game we're going to talk about is For Sale. Now, I've played this game for years. A friend of mine, London, he taught me how to play this one back in Hawaii when I was out there, and fell in love with the game then. I think this is one of the best games ever. I think it's the best filler game, period. And this is just incredible game in general. I love this one. Now, that being said, there is one very small and very key thing that we were doing wrong in this game. So during this game, you're going to be having an open auction at the start. There'll be four or however many players you're playing with that many cards on the table, and you'll be using your coins here to bid on those cards. Now, each card, whenever you bid, you're always bidding on the highest one. So it's my turn, I bid $3. The next person can either outbid me, or they can take the lowest card. Now, if it ever gets back to you and you still have money, if you decide to drop out, you actually lose half of your money when you drop out. So you'll still take the lowest card, but you lose half. So there's an incentive to kind of push forward, but you also have to know when to quit and when it might not be worth the money. So really interesting auctioning system there. Now, the thing we were doing wrong is when you pass and lose half your money, we always said that, I learned that when you do that, you lose half your money rounded up. And that was huge, because it was meaning that you were having to take more aggressive bids. You were having to kind of go on odd numbers and, you know, overbid just a little bit. Sorry, you were going on even numbers and going up a little bit. So it was pretty, you were spending a lot more money that way. Now, the actual rule is you round down, and that's huge. That might seem like a very small rule, and it is, but that has huge implications. This just means that overall, you're going to have more money during that auction round, which makes for more interesting auctions, which is huge. Once again, very small rule, but huge implications. So that's For Sale. When you drop out of a bid, you make sure that you get rid of half your money, round it down. So that's a big one. So that is For Sale. The next game we're going to talk about is Inish. Inish is a game where you play as these Celtic clans, and it's your job to satisfy one of three win conditions before the start of the next round, tell everybody you're doing it, and then hopefully hold that claim until the next round is has begun. So really interesting game. It has this great drafting card play. I love the artwork in this one. My favorite part of this game has to be the drafting system itself, though. I love how you get this hand of four, you pick one of the cards, you pass the rest, you get your other three, you look at those, but you add any cards you kept to that hand, and so you can kind of mix and match what cards you're drafting, which is really cool. So I really like how you can kind of, you know, flow and the plan is really smooth. But another interesting thing about this is those win conditions. And that is one thing that we actually had incorrect, was one of the win conditions. So the three win conditions of the game, there's one where you have to control, you have to be in six different places. The other, so you've got this big map with lots of tiles, you got to be in six places. The other one is you need to have sanctuaries and areas you control. Those are those brown spots. And the last thing you need to do is you have to be chieftain, which just means you have more pieces in an area than another person, than other people, but you have to have six total enemy pieces in areas where you're chieftain. Now, originally, we just thought that this meant that there has to be six enemy pieces in a single spot where you are chieftain of. And that is not the case. You just have to be, in general, chieftain over six people total in all the areas you control. Like in here, for instance, orange has three pieces and blue has two, so that would be two for the total that orange is racking up. So orange would probably want to maybe even bring some people in here, populate this area with enemy pieces so that they can reach that number. So I think that's really cool how this kind of incentivizes there's a mechanic in the game where you can peacefully enter regions. Normally, when you enter a region, you're going to fight, but you can actually talk about it and say, hey, I don't really want to fight. And that is huge, because if you have enemy pieces scattered amongst all your regions where you're chieftain, then that helps with that win condition. So the first game we played with this, that win condition didn't come up. But in every other game that we've played, that has been very key. And that really adds to the interesting choices in the game. It makes peaceful resolutions much more commonplace than it was before. And it's just a really fascinating system. I really like that system. So that is the Chieftains. So the win condition, one of the win conditions for Inish is you need to have six enemy pieces in areas where you are chieftain over. The next game that we're going to talk about is Oath, Chronicles of Empire and Exiles. This is a fantastic game. Love this one. You play in this kingdom that is changing every game you play, and your whole goal is to either maintain Oathkeeper if you are Chancellor by fulfilling some sort of condition, or to usurp the Chancellor as an exile by doing the condition better than them or fulfilling your personal vision and quest. You do this through the use of denizen cards, and the denizens are my favorite part of the game. They're these awesome cards that all have special abilities and suits, and they all really change the game. You can play them on the board as like a buildable tableau that everyone can use, or you can keep them for yourself as advisors for your own personal tableau of abilities. So I really like that whole concept. Amazing. Now, the thing that we got wrong in this game, there's two things, actually. The first thing has to do with drawing denizens. So here is the game board itself, and if you look at the top here, this is a discard pile. So generally, when you're drawing cards in this game, new denizens, new people to help you out, you're going to draw from the world deck, and that's down here. Now, every time you search, it has a certain cost and action point, so it's two normally, and when you draw cards, you draw three, and then if you hit vision cards, the little eyeball cards, the cost of drawing from the deck increases, so kind of interesting. Now, that being said, when our first couple of games, it became prohibitively expensive very quickly to draw new cards, so we just weren't drawing as many cards from the deck, and it felt kind of lacking. However, as we actually, you know, went back and read the rules again and found something, we totally forgot that you can search from a discard pile, and it always costs two. And that's huge. We thought when you search from the discard pile, you pay the cost that was here, the two, three, or four, based on the number of visions. And so that was... oh, that was huge. That was game-breaking. So this actually made the game extremely better the next time we played, because we realized, oh, you can just grab suits from the discard pile. That's awesome. Or you could strategically discard things in a specific piles, and you'd know where they are. You'd be able to pick up visions that you'd made discarded. It was really cool. So I really like the system here, and that's a huge rules change. So it costs only two supply, two action points when you search from a discard pile, no matter what the amount of visions that you've drawn have been. The other rule that we got wrong has to do with these two pieces over here, the Banner of the People's Favor and the Banner of the Darkest Secret. So these are basically special items that you can get during the game that give you special abilities, and they're also part of certain win conditions. Now, when you claim them, you either have to pay Secrets, which are this blue resource, or Favor, which is the gold resource. Now, when you pay those, we thought that you just had to pay one more than that was there. So if there was one secret, you could only pay two. Or if there's one favor, you could only pay two favor. You can actually spend as much as you want, though, and that is gigantic. Some of the win conditions on the game are have the people's favor. So if you stock up a bunch of favor, you can spend it all initially and just put like 7 or 8 or 9 favor on there, and boom, it's going to take a long time for somebody to be able to take that from you. And that's huge. I think that's significant, and it's, you know, it's a big part of the game. That's huge. We played a game where we didn't realize you could do that, and there was not very much favor on the people's favor, and so it kept on changing hands, and every time it's seized by battle, you're going to lose half of the resource or two of the resources on it. And so that kept on happening, so it really was just, you know, hot potato over here. Everybody was taking it. So there was no real reason to go after that win condition because it just kept on getting, you know, taken. It wasn't worth it. So in future games, though, now that we know that you can overpay for these things and bolster up the protection, huge, huge difference, changes the games up drastically. Love it. So that is Oath. The two rules are, first, you can overpay for people's favor and the Banner of the Darkest Secret. The second thing is, when you draw from a discard pile, it always costs 2 supply, no matter how many visions have been revealed. So that's huge. And the last game I want to talk about is for the game Nidavellir. Now, Nidavellir has you playing as a bunch of dwarves, and your whole thing is you are assembling an army of dwarves to go take down the dragon Fafnir. So you're going to be visiting taverns and recruiting these dwarves and trying to get sets of dwarves so that you can recruit heroes. Now, if you look here, these are the dwarves themselves, and each dwarf has a banner that's on them, and the number of banners determines basically the abilities they have. So the more greens you have, you square those, the more purples you have, you get extra points, and you just add the blues and reds, and those are your points. If you have the most blue red banners, you get a bonus at the end, and then the oranges here, you add up all the numbers and then multiply by the number of orange banners. So right off the bat, really strong, the banners are powerful. Now the thing we got wrong is actually one of the most key mechanics in the game, and actually I have not played it right yet after this, because this one is currently in storage, but oh my gosh, I couldn't believe this is happening and that we messed this one up. It's huge. And that is the heroes. So in this game, you can recruit heroes. So there are these awesome characters over here. They have really good abilities and some game-changing effects. And really, you're going to kind of revolve your strategy around these heroes. Now, to get a hero, you have to have 5 different colored banners. So if I got, so we have 4 here, 5 here, 5 here, 5, and 4. So if I got another green and another red, I could claim one of those heroes, and I simply just add it to my army. Now, we were playing where the banners were important for scoring, and that they work the same way for scoring, but in order to get a hero, you just had to have 1 hero card in each section. So it didn't matter how many banners a specific hero had. And as you saw with these heroes, they have multiple of the same color of banners. So we were basically shortchanging everybody by requiring more cards as opposed to more banners. And that's actually another huge implication of this game because, you know, if you're buying these things with multiple banners, you can, like, potentially chain after chain after chain after chain these big hero turns. And so I felt really bad about that because we had played a lot of games where certain characters had, you know, somebody had lots of banners on multiple cards, but unfortunately, because of the way we're playing, they didn't get as many heroes as they should have. And that's just not as fun, right? Because the whole cool thing about this is getting those heroes onto your side and recruiting them. So that is a huge part in this game. And that's the last one we're going to talk about. That is, in Nidavellir, to recruit a hero, you have to have 5 different colored banners and not hero cards. So different banners will get you the heroes. It's huge. And that is everything. That is my 5 more board game rules mistakes. Have you made any of these mistakes yourself? Did you learn something from this video? What was a rules mistake that you've noticed recently that you'd like to share? I'd love to hear what you think down in the comments below. I do want to go ahead and push. We just recently launched a Patreon page. And so make sure that you have checked that out if you feel like further supporting the channel, so that'd be extremely helpful. Thank you so much for all of the Patreons that are currently helping and supporting the channel. And thank you to the subscribers for the SideGame YouTube channel. Thank you so much for all your support, everything that you do for the channel. Really, really appreciate it. But thank you so much for watching SideGame Strong.